All right, let's get started, everyone. I'd like to call the Somerset School Committee meeting to order on Thursday, September 6th. Do note that it's been posted at North Elementary School at 6:35. Members present, Don Rebello, Bob Camara, Ann Carrera, Victor Machado, and also the chair.
And I would like to call this joint meeting of the Somerset Berkeley Regional School Committee along with the Somerset School Committee to order at 6:35. Do notice having been posted. Roll call, Ms. White.
Here.
Mr. Machado.
Present.
Mrs. Gagliotti.
Here.
Mr. Souza.
Here.
Chair is present. I was informed by Mr. Patrick that he's unable to be here this evening, and Mr. Kelly has informed us that he is on the way and will arrive shortly. Also with us tonight, the Superintendent of Schools, Richard Medeiros, Director of Business and Finance, Mark Furtado, Director of Technology, Raymond Necris, and our Recording Secretary, Michelle Corsier, I'm sorry.
Pledge allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I think just moving on right into open session, Mr. Medeiros, Director of Special Education.
Susan, thank you. I provided an overview of all staffing for both districts, both Somerset and the region. On the agenda tonight is the Director of Special Education position. Unfortunately, and so quite reluctantly, I accepted the resignation of the Director of Special Education, Susan Doe. I provided that letter just to the group last week. To both boards during their meeting, and certainly in open session today, I want to discuss kind of an interim strategy as it relates to filling that position, and then maybe a long-term strategy as it relates to the support of the board. What I've provided in your packet is a resume of an individual who has done some similar work for a close community that I'm familiar with. I've had an opportunity to speak to the administration there, and I think it may address our immediate concerns in relation to liability, consulting services, and it would secure out-of-district placement and a variety of other tasks. And I'd like to engage in at least a dialogue and look for the support for the boards moving forward considering the time frame of Mrs. Doe's departure, which would be as early as September 17th when you back out all the time frame within what was owed to her. So considering that's a pretty quick turnaround, today is September 6th. I think we do have an interim strategy. I'd like to talk to you about that today, and depending on the two chairs want to hear that, I think maybe we should discuss that strategy first and then consider what I put together, which was a draft of what the posting would look like, and we can proceed accordingly based on time frame. Obviously, I didn't put salary and those types of things as it relates, but I think it's a good starting point. So, Mr. Souza, Mr. Pierce, I can go to the specifics of what dialogue I've had with Pat Cosgrove, which is the resume you have there, and what we would do in the short term to address special education services for both the region and K-8 in Somerset, if you'd like. Address that issue and talked about some specifics behind that and what myself and Mrs. Doe have done up to this point to ensure that there's continuity and consistency and no exposure as it relates to liability for services for kids. And I feel real confident that we can address that short term based on looking at some of these services. If you want me, Mr. Susan, Mr. Pierce, to proceed, I can go into some more detail. I just wanted to make sure that people understood what they were doing and know what they were looking at.
Before we get into the replacement, as you know, I requested a copy of Mrs. Doe's contract just this afternoon, and I refresh my recollection that when we extended her contract in January of 2011, the provisions related to termination of her contract were amended, and she was required to give at least 120 days' notice. Now, she notified us last week, and she's leaving on the 17th of September. How did we get to that point, when she's contractually obligated to give us 120 days' notice?
I mean, we certainly can hold to the contract. That has not been a practice in relation to administrators here, and some of the boards, so they can consider.
So we waited 90 days for Mr. Furtado to satisfy the notice requirement under his contract, and we specifically included these provisions in these contracts when we extended them so that we wouldn't be left in this kind of position. So I'm just concerned that we accepted Mrs. Doe's resignation. I thought this contract language was put in place so we wouldn't find ourselves in this position.
You had mentioned that we owe her days and stuff like that. How many days is that?
I think it was in the total 20-some days. I think her letter read in mid-October, Victor, and so, but backed out to those days, it led to September 17th, final work day.
And that was assuming it was 90 days, though, right? Notice? Was that
the time?
So let me get this.
How would it be based on 90 days?
Yeah. It wouldn't be based on any days. What I'm
That was an assumption that they took out.
If we got a letter of resignation, you know, I'll be honest with you, hearing Mr. Pierce, I thought, when I received that letter, the resignation letter last week, I thought it said that she was remaining until October something, or her last day was October something. I don't hear that her last day is September 17th. Is it 17th? You know, if you're asking my opinion, I'm going to agree with Mr. Pierce. I'd like to hold her to the 120 days.
The date was October 16th, that it would be her last day of work.
And how did it get to October 16th?
I don't know. That's just a letter that she, I'm just making sure, clarification, because you didn't say the date.
I just had a hard time losing our special needs director 9 days from today. Today's the 6th? 11 days from today. That's difficult to handle. That's not even a notice. That's just, if you're looking for, I don't accept her resignation with, personally, your resignation was sent to the superintendent, not to the school committee. And also, I don't accept, you know, ending less than 120 days minus the 20 some odd days that is owed to her.
I didn't receive a copy of the letter.
I guess you did.
Could she not use sick days, vacation days? I mean, she could utilize those days. So it really wouldn't even be in the building. Am I wrong thinking that?
Well, that's those days.
That's the days that she's
backed out from October.
Okay. So she's got us in the corner, really. From where I'm sitting, there's not a lot that we can do. I mean, contractually, she's within the guidelines.
No, she isn't. No, 120 days from last week, things are all going to December, give or take days. Minus the 20 days, that takes her out to November. Where she, what's doing is she gave us a date, not even following her contract, and then she eliminates another 30 days off of that, or 20 some odd days off of that.
Right. I think when we took the vote, understanding that she was going to work until that date in the letter, then back it out.
maybe we should hear about the proposal to deal with the situation.
The proposal involves a retired director of special education. You see her resume there, quite extensive. She actually works for the Partnerships Senior Staff Consultant. She was the director of special education in Mansfield for 10 years. All of last year, she filled this consulting service role for the Dyker-Hobart Regional School District when they did not have a special education director for the entire year, and adequately met their needs there and had an opportunity to speak to the administration over there as well. Four colleagues, brings with her a wealth of experience as it relates to special education. I had an opportunity to meet with her to discuss the fact that I would be potentially looking at this as an option. She's not looking for a title or position, but she is has clearly stated to me and articulated that she would handle all those responsibilities of the special education director, short of out-of-district placements, and I've talked to a retired special needs chair from the high school, Katie Perry Andrew, in town about handling that task. So the two of them combined, being paid on a per diem hour basis, would handle the tasks and responsibilities until we had a permanent replacement for the director of special education. I only share the Dyker-Hobart piece because it's the most current in relation to Mrs. Cosgrove's performance and the fact that they were able to maintain their services for nearly an entire year under this format effectively and efficiently. Obviously, ideally, you want a special ed director, but in the instance of Dyker-Hobart, they weren't able to do that, and she was able to carry out this task in a similar type of school district. So I think the model at least exists. My hope would be certainly that we would not have to wait an entire year to have a person on the board, but I also feel the sense of need starting a school year to be sure that we're in place. She's actually pretty intimately involved and has been involved in the school system in Somerset in relation to some previous work, not with the current special education director, but previous directors, both Mrs. LaSalle and Mrs. Backlund. Mrs. Cosgrove did some consulting work and some follow-up, and her resume's there, and I certainly could make her available to what's felt, but considering the time sensitivity to all this, I simply wanted to assure the both boards that we have an adequate replacement as it relates to any of the services of students moving forward. So
what would be your recommendation for the per diem?
She actually made a proposal of as a consultant working for Walker Partners, she would write a contract at $160 an hour. I think we would just have to set some parameters, and I can tell you what they did in Dyker-Hobart, and I can make a recommendation here. In Dyker-Hobart, I think their recommendation was to max out her services at 75 hours a month. We had a discussion with Mrs. Cosgrove in relation to the fact that because some out of district was being handled by someone else, we maybe had to limit the hours per month to 60 hours. So if you just do the quick math, at $160 an hour in consulting services for 60 hours maximum, it would come to about $9,600 a month to handle 504 and special education services in a consulting capacity. In addition, Mrs. Perry Andrews' hourly rate, she's done some grant work with us. This activity has been $80 an hour. We did not determine what the cap would be on out-of-district. It would be far less, obviously, because it would just be handling out-of-district placements, but maybe somewhere in the range of 15 hours. So you could do that math as well. So that would be my proposal. It's not necessarily a per diem daily rate. Mr. Souza would be more reflective of her being available any day of the week that would need, but may not necessarily be for an entire day. It may not be for two full days, but it would be that maximum, just to establish the fact that this is not an endless hourly rate, that you can work up to 120 hours scenario. I raised some concerns, quite frankly, that 160 hours can do it, and she felt confident based on the discussion that she had with Mrs. Doe that would be possible to carry out the task. So
for
60 hours.
60 hours.
At $160 an hour, 60 hours a month.
And then it would be 60 hours a month for the out of district?
No.
15
no,
hours per
no,
week?
15
for a month.
Yeah, the out of district placement would be far less.
Can I ask why, and maybe you mentioned it and I missed it, why would recommended consultant Mrs. Cosgrove be able to handle out-of-district placement? Is there a reason why that she wouldn't do that as well? And that way you only have one person doing it?
We could do that. It's a more costly piece, and Mrs. Perry Andrew has done some of that work for the district before, and so it was really an initiative we had. I certainly can engage in discussion as it relates. You mean within the parameters of the hour?
Yeah, within the...
I think we'd have to expand the hours, and when you look at the difference in cost and what we were getting.
Oh, so the difference is you're going to 60 hours per month so that you don't have her doing the out-of-district placement, whereas in Dayton Hovitz, the 75
that
hours was every month.
Yes, did include that.
This is, I'm trying, I'm no mathematician yet, but we're paying a salary-based person for special ed to work 40-plus hours per week, and now we're bringing a position down to approximately maybe like 18, 20 hours a week. Why are we, I mean, this is a very vital position. So we're going from a full-time person to now just a part-time. I just don't see how that works.
And how
everything can be done because of all the laws and time frame to get certain things in. I mean, are we able to manage that? Doing it with that limited of time?
Yeah, if I could interject a little bit. What you're buying is experience. When you talk about the complexity involved in special educational services, regardless of where you are, Ann probably knows better than I do. You could not pay enough for experience. It's immensely valuable. Good experience, when you qualify that. So I'm assuming what you buy here is really good experience. It's not perfect, but you're at a time of year where it's not like you're going to put your hook in the water and get a fish. It's going to be extremely challenging to fill the role, regardless of what you do. So in terms of the short term, make sure you don't have a flood. This is a pretty good answer.
And I would just add, I think in a parallel to this, we proceed with a posting and pursue getting a permanent replacement. I'm not suggesting that we sit on the other aspect, and that's why I have the posting there. I think we proceed trying to bring someone in, and obviously then we can curtail services if in fact we are able to secure our next director of special education. I'm in no way pretending, as Mark kind of said, that this is the perfect solution to this issue. I've simply shared where colleagues have done it. Other districts have performed this task. Certainly your experience, wealth of experience really in relation to Massachusetts special education, I think permits her to maybe be a little bit more efficient in relation to this piece, in addition to the fact that we do have team chairs, school psychologists at levels that in some school districts they do not have.
This is just an interim basis.
Yeah, absolutely. This is not in any way a long-term solution to the issue of finding a director of special education, and I would recommend that we proceed with a posting as soon as possible. But it is the reality that we need to have someone handling these services in the short term as we look to get someone.
Mr. Chair?
If nothing more from a liability perspective, sorry.
Oh, yeah, Mr. Mello first.
Rick, did she, Ms. Cosgrove, work the entire year in Dyker Hobart? Did I hear you say?
Yes. She's actually still doing some mentoring with the current special education director there.
Now, a couple of questions regarding that. When she was there, just out of curiosity, do you have knowledge that a similar arrangement was made with her regarding hours per month, or was she on a binder for the hours?
Yeah, no, this arrangement is modeled from...
It mirrors the
Reduced because of the out-of-district reduction, but similar.
Now, in Dayton, was her longevity perhaps related to the fact that they were having difficulty finding a replacement?
Absolutely.
I'm going to tell you folks something, which is what I was assuming, because I know a little bit about the challenges in finding someone who's highly qualified with this position. So, and I hear what Mr. Pierce said regarding the predecessor to perhaps Ms. Cosgrove, but I think we have to, I perhaps would rather move forward than entertain dealing with a lame duck, to be honest with you. I think we better move quickly to lock someone in before this person or any other individual we consider takes another job they're difficult to find, and I think we better think in terms of long-term, because it's going to be challenging to find a highly qualified replacement for her. And, you know, I personally would trust the superintendent's judgment. He's conferred with the officials in Dayton. It's a good school district. If you did the job there, I think we better consider acting quickly than debating and toying around with this thing a long time. Thank you.
Anne?
I'm disappointed that the names came out publicly tonight. I don't think that was appropriate. Our vote was taken in the executive session. We were asked not to discuss this. Obviously, people outside knew before the Somerset residents and teachers knew. I think, and I'm not saying these people, the two people you bring forward aren't qualified, but personally, I think we should post the interim, let them apply, and see the other candidates, in all fairness. I mean, there are other people that I know of that may be interested, but that's besides the point. The fact is that all of us did not, no one approached anyone, no one talked to anyone, and I just feel badly that these names are up there now.
Yeah, I can say in this example that this individual specifically is not interested in an interim position, so, I mean, it may limit her interest in relation to other responsibilities that she has.
Well, we could post interim / consultant, however we call it. I just feel uncomfortable that someone was already involved before we even had this discussion.
Yeah, and again, I can assume responsibility for that. It was my concern from a liability perspective that both districts would be compromised by not having someone to oversee these services. Significant liability as it relates. And so I did take that opportunity without, you know, requesting an additional meeting, knowing that we had a meeting coming up to engage in discussion with the understanding that obviously we would need some board approval.
Well, we didn't realize it was so immediate either, because we had an October date.
And I'm gonna go back to that piece. I thought we had a lot more time. I have a very difficult time believing that there isn't other people out there who just may have just retired, who is looking for some extra, like an additional position. But $160, you know, granted they're not working here full time. We're used to having someone here for 40 hours a week. But $160 an hour times 2080, that's like $330,000. I don't care how much of an expert you are. You know, granted we're not paying her $330,000 a year, but you're telling me we can't find anyone in a month, at least put out the word and take postings? Since when? You know, we did that for the business and finance director. Why? Because we had X amount of days to do so. This is, I'm resigning and I'm leaving. I'm sorry, lame duck or not. You know what? We have to stop holding people responsible. You know, North Attleboro did it to us. We honored that. And whatever district Mrs. Doe is going to needs to understand she had a contract with us that says 120 days. And you know what? Why are we putting this stuff in the contract only a year ago if we're not going to enforce it? Why? Let's eliminate it, because I think we're looking like a joke. I personally think it is a joke. You know, people can just get up and leave. We have to honor them, their contract for a year to X amount of years, but these people can just get up and go? Unacceptable. It's time that we, you know what? You sign a contract, we're holding you to it. Contact your employer that you're being held to your contract. And hopefully they understand that. And now we're not looking at a $160 consultant when we can, in fact, put out a posting, give us some time. Because what happens if we're in a situation, this is a very difficult time to look for a special needs director. Everyone is saying that. But who says we're going to find someone in a month? We may not. Are we going to continue to pay this $160 consultant fee plus another stipend to someone else for our out-of-district students? I'm asking my co-members to hold Mrs. Doe to her contract and we put out the posting. That's the only way I can vote on, because having one applicant, and I don't believe, and trust me, I believe Mrs. Gosgrove can do the job, but I'd like to know what else is out there. There might be an alternate decision that we can make. Instead, this is the only option we have, and whenever I only have one option, my vote is always no. I don't like to be put under the gun.
I understand what you're saying. I share frustration.
I see this as two different issues. I think right now we're in a very precarious situation. Without a SBR director, boy, are we opening ourselves up legally for a lot of trouble. I just feel uncomfortable right now, this minute, because school's opening up and we don't have a SBR director in place. There's nothing more legal than special ed. So I would support getting someone for an interim basis, even if it's a consultant fee that is difficult to accept. I think we need to get someone in place who knows the laws, who's familiar with the position, who can do this to hold us over. And maybe this discussion should evolve around effective date. But I think we need to fill that hole right now and then deal with the contract that we had with the former SBR director.
So are you suggesting, Liz, that we have both in place, that we contract with Ms. Cosgrove and Katie Perry Andrew, but at the same time negotiate to keep our current director in place? She's here until the 17th. So are you suggesting that we negotiate with her to keep her in place longer, but already identify these two people?
I think we need to get someone in place right now. I don't think.
So are you saying?
Yes, because right now, from what I'm hearing, I wasn't here last meeting. I didn't vote on anything. I didn't know what the committee's plans were. So this is all new for me. I'm hearing this right now.
The regional committee hasn't addressed this issue in a meeting previously.
And the Somerset School Committee did not take a vote. Accepting resignation.
They were informed.
We were just informed.
Oh, I guess I misunderstood. We took
a motion to discuss options. That was the only motion that we took.
Okay. Right now, I'm just a little nervous with not having, from what I understand, from what I'm hearing tonight, we have a SBR director who's boxing up her office and moving into a new office. That leaves us vulnerable as a district, extremely vulnerable. I think we need to get somebody in that seat fast. So be it if we have two bodies in the same office for 2 weeks, because utilize that person to transition the new person, update them, fill them in on the background of the kids that are involved and the families, and be able to touch base with those families to notify them. I mean, there's a lot that can be done with both people in that office. And I don't even know if they're going to have time to do that.
I have a resume in my hand from an individual who has provided consulting services to the Somerset School Committee within the last few years, a retired special education director with about 30 years experience, who I contacted this afternoon and expressed interest in the position and indicated that he would consider a fee significantly below $160 an hour. So I would ask the superintendent to at least be in touch with this individual and see if he is a viable option, and to perhaps at least extend some additional feelers to see if there are other people who might be available, because I have the impression that the person who is being proposed works for a consulting firm, and that some of this $160 an hour is going to the consulting firm rather than to the individual involved. And I think we may well be able to find a person with equal qualifications, as we did with the director of business and finance, for a cost that's considerably less. That's just my impression.
Yeah, I think that's great, but I think we need to.
Well, my understanding, when the resignation came in, I thought the dates were being backed out, and October 16th was her final day, and then she was taking her sick time and vacation time following that piece. I did not realize that she was using the October 16th day and then backing off of that, you know, and I mean, I think if we hold her to at least something, I think having a lame duck, I don't agree with it, but holding her to something, so I think Ann made a good point, and Rick as well. I think we need to make sure that we just kind of go out there and see what else is out there too, and not just being chosen to one person. But it's very vital to have that position covered, because, I mean, well, as I said, I mean, we are holding ourselves to major liability.
I mean, I
of not having that position filled. I just don't want to, you know, put us into a corner and say, and I think her, you know, this person that you brought forward, I'm looking at her resume and it seems very, very good, you know, resume. But there possibly could be some several other options that could hold us over that we could be bringing in. And on top of that, I mean, the school committee does not, I believe the school committee hires and, you know, fires the special education director. So, I mean, under the joint policy too, we need to make sure that there's something in place that we're making sure that, you know, whoever we're bringing in is being brought in by the school committee as well. And we put that policy in place.
Are you talking about an interim position? Or are you talking about...
Okay. I mean, even a consultant, I think it's even a consultant. I mean, this is a position that is very vital. I think, you know, the school committee should have, you know, their say in who that person is coming in.
If I may, again, my intent, and hate to bring in the K-8, I basically had an abrupt resignation of a principal. I took some immediate action, looked into my resources and my professionalism, came together with what I thought would be a short-term solution to that issue. I did not advertise, I did not seek advertisement, we didn't post, we didn't recruit, and there certainly probably are other viable candidates out there. I brought to the board in Somerset last week what my recommendation was. Likewise, what I was doing tonight is trying to provide both these boards with a similar situation, which here's a short-term solution to address what is an immediate concern that I have. I would recommend, whatever decision we make tonight, that we post immediately the Director of Special Education position. I don't even necessarily think it needs to be interim, quite frankly, unless you're not satisfied with how we're adequately meeting the needs. And see what's out there. You go on school spring tomorrow. And for both districts, and we should do that. I don't think we should delay the process. We clearly know that this is, whatever decision we make tonight, it's not a long-term solution to this. But I brought that individual forward, not saying that there weren't other candidates who could handle that piece. Likewise, I don't dispute. In fact, I have some friends and professionally and personally that were colleagues in this district that I know potentially may have that expertise. But I will say the dramatic changes in landscape in the last several years as it relates to special education and expectation really requires someone who has been kept up to speed in relation to that. And I think this person meets that. Not that there aren't other people out there. I just don't want there to be a gap in relation to trying to acquire those services over time.
I think the difference with the interim position for the Wilbur School was we brought somebody in that was previously a principal here. We brought them in a full-time basis, even though it was a per diem, to cover the same salary that was met from the predecessor. This is different. This is someone that bringing forward that is extremely higher than who we have in that position. And we know that position has been, you know, a lot lower in this district than other districts. So I think, you know, I would rather just see a couple of different, some more options.
Yes. So your recommendation would be we hire Ms. Cosgrove on a consulting basis. Would it be like a month-to-month type of?
It may be less than. I wouldn't actually say we hire. I say we enter into a contract that she provides services for both districts that address the needs of special education.
Okay.
And I certainly could provide that to the boards. That was my recommendation short term. I don't think there's any. I think until a position is filled, quite frankly, and as Mr. Bella kind of referenced, in Dyton or Hoboken, I don't believe they ever intended Mrs. Cosgrove to be there for the entire year. They were looking for a business manager and a special education director at the same time, and it took over a year for that.
So So you think she's qualified and she'd do a good job while we're in this
while
situation?
While we're in search, and I think we have to accelerate the search, yes.
And I guess my I think I agree with Mr. Rebello on the fact that I think you need to move quickly. I would rather have her in place as soon as possible, have her consult with the current director before she leaves. I don't think there's anything stopping us in the interim from doing two things. Look for another consultant that's cheaper, and then depends on how we negotiate this card. But if you do a week to week, month to month, there's nothing wrong with looking at other consultants who are cheaper, and we can renegotiate with Ms. Coswell. I mean, there's a lot of things we can do, but I think the most important thing is if you have someone qualified who's done this before, who can step in now, my thought was with the kids, with the liability, with everything else, just to move on that, how slowly this process can take with two school committees. And if you have someone who's superintendent believes in, who's done this before, I don't see any reason why not to do this right now. It doesn't stop us from looking at other consultants. It doesn't stop us from posting for an interim or a director in the future, but I don't see how we don't act on this. If we say no and we meet next week for another consultant and we have interviews, I mean, it drags on. Why not tie this or go into negotiation with this person now, get her in here now so she can meet with the director, get up to speed and everything. She's doing the job while we look for a consultant or while we look for a director. I don't see how we get harmed in any way by doing that. I think it benefits the school districts and the kids tremendously. So, for me, the situation is terrible, absolutely. But I think we can do two things. We can look backwards and try and see what we do contractually. Maybe we can learn from this, and then the next contract we can put in some provisions that if you violate this, this is what happens. And we can put some damage clauses in the next contract in regards to what can happen if you violate the contract. But I think we need to move forward. We got to look at what's best interest of the kids and the district. And if we have someone qualified who's there right now, we can take in right now. I don't see why we would want to wait. If it doesn't harm us, if we can still look for a consultant that's cheaper in the future or a director.
I just want to make a couple of points. One thing, this is unfortunately a pattern that we've had in this district. Last year with Mr. Furtado's predecessor, we let him go early. We've done it again now with Mrs. Doe. We have seven school days before Mrs. Doe leaves. I don't like being held over the barrel. I think this is, I think we should have held her. I agree with Mr. Machado, we should have held her. At this point, she's gone, so I guess we don't really have much of a say in that, unfortunately. I agree with Mr. Rebello. I think Mrs. Cosgrove is certainly adequately qualified. The price may be a bit of a bitter pill for us to swallow, frankly. But at this point, I don't know that we're over a barrel. I don't think we have much of a choice at this point. If we have to get this individual in, I agree. I don't want us to be open to any sort of liability when it comes to special education. It's too important to the district.
Is there any benefit or possibility to doing a little bit of both, as George suggested, and trying to see if we have any leeway with our current administrator to keep her here for at least a little bit more to help the transition? Should it be Ms. Cosgrove or whoever it is, I think there would be some benefit. And then my other question is, do we have the finances to cover that, depending on how long?
I mean, the combination of actually paying for the services and...
Yeah. I mean,
because yes,
7 days
isn't
a lot of time to transfer all that information, is what I'm thinking. There's a number of students that are on IEPs and all that. All of that information can be transferred to one individual, whoever that is, mm-hmm. as qualified as they might be. It's going to be difficult to get that over.
Yeah, I mean, Mark, you can speak to the finance. I think that would be less of an issue. I think our priority should be how you want to proceed. I don't know if the chairs want to speak to the current special education director. I certainly can do that as well.
Is there a possibility to do, I mean, the contract reads that there should be a lengthier time here before leaving? Is that correct?
It's 120.
The finances is based on the... If you look at the hours he's recommended,
right.
And the salary is about $2,600 to $3,000 more a month.
But I think that it actually has more of a positive impact if you're able to couple that with someone staying, get a transfer that.
If you were able to accomplish that, clearly, I think it would be a benefit, Julie. I would agree. You could do both, and it wouldn't be all costly.
I think, too, I understand what the other people.
George came up with a great compromise where we could, you know, get her, you know, Ms. Cosgrove and Ms. Andrews contracted. We can look out to see if there is other services that are a lot less that meet the same needs. And then on top of it, I think that we could definitely talk to the current person and hold her to her contract at least a little bit longer.
I just don't want to see us spend money ineffectively, because I think, you know, no matter who we bring in at a level like that, if they don't have enough information to carry that going forward, you know, that transition piece, I think, Liz, you're right, is crucial. In 7 days, I was trying to say,
Judge just reworded to make it a little bit easy to understand. I mean, I think we're both saying the same thing here. We have multiple balls in the air that we're trying to juggle. We need to plug the hole right now. I think looking at this all as one big problem, I think we need to just separate it. We have the current spend director that we need to deal with because we're not happy with the situation right now. We have a high priority position that we need to fill because there are a lot of kids that we need to make sure are taking care of the opening of school. And then we have the financial piece. And I think it's in that art, you have the financial piece that we have the money because we need to, but we're going to take it from somewhere else if we have to. So
I think if we can do it in those three pieces, I think we try to address all the issues that have been brought up.
We can do it simultaneously.
Yeah. Right. I mean, I think we, part of the reason is we don't like to be left in this position where we have such a limited time to make a sound decision. So we need to address that, I think, with the negotiations with the current director. If we make the transition is going to happen no matter what, as George said, let's get somebody in. But I think we need to open our options in the third piece and advertise that right away and not keep ourselves coming.
You were really, at the last meeting, the regional meeting, we all looked at our calendar to see if we could all meet today. Luckily, we all were able to meet today. Because if we weren't able to meet today, in 9 days or 11 days, we would have no SPED director, special needs director, if we could not meet today. Honestly, this is a major insult from an employee that I attempted to keep, that we actually voted to try to keep. Come back.
There was no vote.
There was a vote. In executive session, we took a vote, I believe, or we all agreed. But I'm just saying, I think it's very wrong to leave within that many days. You know what? If we allow this to go through without holding Mrs. Doe to her contract, I think we are basically looking like fools. For an interim business director, we had interviews. We're ready to grab the very first candidate we have. I understand this is a very important role, but we have a special needs director. Like it or not, we have a special needs director who is under a contract until December with us, at least until December. I don't look like we're we don't have one. I really don't. All I know is, Mr. Furtado, we waited. The other district should understand. She needs to write whatever district she's going to a letter saying that the Somerset School Committee is holding her to her contract. Because that was the letter that we received from Mr. Furtado, saying that the Attleboro School Committee is holding me to my contract. The earliest date I can get to is this. Do you still want me after this date? That's the letter she should have sent back to him. Honestly, this is just wrong. You know, in a pot where, in addition, I will always be available by phone, and you know, in your, you know what? That's foolish. That's false hope on this letter. Just false hope. disappointing. Extremely disappointing. You know, no one would have done this. You know, no one. Everyone, at least people give a 2 weeks notice. We got a, you know, a 2 weeks notice. That's what most people give to their boss when it's a non-professional environment. This is a professional environment where kids are involved, and we're getting nothing but 7 days prior, and now another 11 days, 3 weeks. And we're not going to hold her to 100, we're not even holding her to a month. That's wrong, gentlemen. I mean, ladies and gentlemen, I think that's just wrong. And you know what? I understand it's a very important position, but we still need to hold her responsible and to ask the taxpayer, you know what? I look at it at $160 an hour. I don't know if our K-8 budget has that. We are going to be stealing it from another location. Technically, I think I'm not willing to, you know, I'm not looking to take a vote. I'm sure we'll have a vote today, but I'm just saying, how do we make a vote to spend money when we already have someone in this position, in this role? And personally, I hope the other district that Mrs. Go is going is really watching this. Because you know what? It always happens again and again and again.
FMCS is not accountable.
Victor, you can keep voicing outrage, and I think we all are, but at some point we got to be responsible and make decisions on what's best for the kids in the district. Is there a number, when you say you're not going to hold Susan Doe, you can't keep her locked her in this building and say work until November or December. She's made a decision to leave, she's met with her to leave. Now, whether the district wants to pursue legal action against her, charge her for the $160 an hour, I mean, there's certain things you can do. Hopefully we can sit down with her. Maybe she stays a little bit longer. I mean, there's certain, but we got to make decisions on what to do now that she's decided to leave. So we got to, as Liz said, we got to compartmentalize this and move forward. So you hire a consultant, you try and get Ms. Stowers here as long as we can. When she decides to go, she goes. Then we make decisions on what we do after that. But we got to move forward. We can't just keep expressing our outrage about this. And then next contract we do, you put damage clauses in. So if someone breaks the contract, it's pretty clear of what happens when they do. So this happened to a couple of times to us now, so we learn from it, and we grow from it, and we make adjustments. But we just can't, we got to move on, I think. We got
to
stop.
Well, I'm willing to move on, but let's also make a motion today that we are going to pursue some legal actions.
I don't know what they are.
But I think we should, one thing we should do is call our attorneys and ask what legal action can we form? Because you know what? I think we need to send a clear message. When you're costing the taxpayers money, I think you need to send a clear message for all further employees.
For me, I'd rather just sit down with her, work it out. Maybe she extends the time a little bit longer, meets with the consultant, and we do what's the best interest of the district, because to me, it's better that way than to sue people. So if we can all sit down together, work together, what's in the best interest of everybody, and we reach an agreement, we move on.
We got that on tape, Judge, by the way.
What?
Oh, better than suing.
That's a terrible result.
Just to be disbanded. I mean, much of what I recommended, although it's been kind of in all the place, is exactly what Mr. Kelly has kind of shared, which is I was never suggesting any one thing. I think the one piece that you brought up tonight, or both boards brought up tonight, is an engaged dialogue with the current director, which I wasn't proposing, but that certainly both chairs could entertain as it relates to extending her time here. I didn't include that, but certainly I think that could be done in addition to providing some services that we know is going to be immediate and necessary, maybe with her longer stay potentially. And then lastly, obviously posting the position. I was never suggesting not doing that. I simply wanted the okay to go ahead and proceed with the posting. And obviously the sooner the better we can get on the school spring, and we can do that as early as tomorrow once we establish what the time frame is. And typically we have some sort of salary parameters as it relates to that. So you can do all those things, and I don't think any one thing prohibits you from doing the other. And I think you probably should be looking at all.
Can I just ask one other question? I don't mean to belabor it. That other individual that Mr. Pierce mentioned, is your concern in bringing someone other than Ms. Cosgrove that they might not have more current information on what the changes in the
I honestly don't know, Julie. I'm not opposed to any competent individual who can do the task. I was in no way suggesting that this one individual is the sole individual who can handle this. I simply know that that she has a connection to the district, has done some work, did that in the neighboring community, was well aware, in no way suggesting there are others. I just know typically when we've done this, and I'll think of the business manager, when we post it for interim, when we then conduct search, you know, a screening, review, it takes time. And my concern is during that time, that anything we might say may be caught by one case. And so I'm not opposed, I don't know who the individual is. Like I said, I actually know someone in the town who I think is someone I'm have a good relationship with, but it doesn't play clue that. I'm just concerned about the timing of it all.
But that's the part that irritates me. You know other people that would be able to, you know, but yet you're bringing just one name to us.
No, I didn't say I know other people that can do the job this person can do. I think this is the right choice for us to make. I simply was suggesting that if someone else had another name, I'm not surprised to hear that maybe there are other people out there.
Mr. Bell?
Number one, to squash debate or expression of opinion, but I think we need to come up with a plan of action. I'm just going to make a suggestion. I think we need to do three things here. Number one, and whether this be done by the superintendent or we delegate from the committee, someone's going to sit down with the current director, explain to her that there are some hard feelings and that perhaps we would pursue action regarding what we consider a contract violation and negotiate for an extended period of time for her, whatever it may be. I think we should put that on the table, get a response from her. Now, she may come back with 3 weeks, whatever, but I think that, number one, has to take place. Number two, we've got to get the position posted. Number three, I think we have to let Ms. Cosgrove know that within a short period of time, we will require her services. I think those three things need to happen tomorrow. Let's move forward. So again, I'm going to repeat communication to the current SBR director of our feelings, get a response from her regarding our request that she not retire on a given date, but that time be extended. Number two, position gets posted. Number three, communication to Ms. Cosgrove that we're going to need her services in a relatively short period of time. On an interim basis, not hiring, purely month by month. My opinion. Let's get going.
So are you making a motion?
Yes. Make a motion?
Yes.
Somerset Committee, we have a motion on the floor by Mr. Bell. Do we have a second on that?
Second.
We have a second. Any further discussion?
I agree with all aspects of the motion except for naming the interim. I think we should post for the interim.
I'm not saying name it. I'm saying that we've got to communicate with her that we may require her services.
So, Mr. Bell, you're basically saying to notify her, to say that we are in the process of looking for her services and put her on notice that she potentially could be the one.
If I may, I'm not suggesting she's the interim special ed director. I'm simply suggesting we contract services so she can provide
month by month,
maybe less than that. So I'm in no way putting her into a position that would need to be posted. I understand that completely. Simply saying that we're looking to obtain her services on a consultant basis. At least that was my.
Is anybody interested in the motion for a second? Is there any reason why you wouldn't want to just say, let's hire her now on a month-to-month basis? So
that's a committee's wish.
Because if the current director says, thanks, but I'm leaving in 11 days, I'd rather have Ms. Cosgrove starting on Monday and consulting with her and moving along. So if you hire her on a month-to-month basis, I don't know how that harms her.
Acceptable to me.
Let me repeat it,
and I'll amend it in accordance with what George just stated, Mr. Kelly just stated. Number one, communication to the current director regarding our sense that she has perhaps violated her contract, along with a request that she extend the period of time that she remains with us.
These should be separate motions.
Okay. You want them separately?
Yes.
I think
it'll be better.
That's so, motion number one.
Motion number one is to post the position.
Let's withdraw the motion.
But yeah.
All right, withdraw the motions.
Mr. Graham?
Motions.
Okay, withdraw. All right, let's go over the posting of the position, because I think that's the easiest one first.
Yep.
So let's knock that one out of the park. So I'm looking for a motion on posting this position immediately.
So moved.
Second.
As an interim or permanent?
Permanent.
I think permanent position. That'd be mine. My take would be, let's...
As it stands...
Permanent, if we have someone that comes play and says that I can do it as an interim basis, you know, for the next year, I think that's up to the, because we, basically under the policy, we would have a joint subcommittee that would interview, would do the search, and would come with candidates to the two committees. Summarizing it very quickly, the policy. So, all right, so we have a motion and a second. Any further discussion?
One discussion.
Yeah.
The last time we posted a principal, Ms. Correa mentioned that she would like a salary range on the posting. Do you still feel that way?
I think we should, because it may make a difference. I'm not sure what we're going to propose on.
Yeah, I don't know. I think relative to the need for this position to fill, and maybe Mr. Rebello feels differently, or other members may, I'd rather we not put a salary on there at this point, because I think we really need to get this posting out. I think Ms. Cogsworth or whoever else would fill this position on a contractual basis. I think we've had some serious discussions recently on salaries and equity and those things. I'd rather we not at this point put that number down.
So it would be based on experience?
Based on experience. And then since we're responsible for hiring this individual, then we can...
Based on experience and negotiable. All right. Motion and second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Chair votes aye as well.
Can I just suggest we have a similar motion?
Yep. I was just going to.
Second.
Is there a motion?
Okay.
Motion made by Mrs. Gagliotti and seconded by Ms. White. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous.
10-day closing day? Any preference?
That's fine.
2-week time frame? Ready?
Yep. Two. Good time.
Motion number two. Send a communication to the current director that we are opposed to her date of retirement, and we want to extend her time in the Somerset School District in accordance with her contractual obligations. Motion.
We have a motion. Do I hear a second?
Second.
Second. Any further discussion?
One question.
Yes.
Your original motion says that also to let her know that we may, in fact, look at any legal actions that we could possibly take.
The one I withdrew?
Yep.
Don, would
the
you...
The one I just made stands.
Would you want the two chairs, the one with the superintendent, to communicate?
I think that makes sense. Yep. The triumvirate should
Thanks.
Send that communication.
Does that have to be a...
I don't know. We can just... Well, it's...
A recommendation.
Recommendation.
You're looking for support.
Yeah. All right, so we have a motion and a second on that. No further discussion. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay. The chair votes aye as well.
Do we have a similar motion from the regional committee?
Well, do we need to take a vote on that? I think it's just a recommendation of support. You're looking for support to approach the existing SBR director.
I think it's more than that. I think the motion is that it's the position of the committee that the director should satisfy the contractual notice requirement.
Yeah, so I think it's a little bit more than a recommendation. I think it's more of saying that there is a vote saying that the committee will hold you to that.
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Motion made by Mr. Machado and seconded by Mrs. Gagliotti. All those in favor?
So the motion. If I want to understand this, I saw Mr. Rebello was basically saying, meet with the director, tell her our concerns about the contract and try and renegotiate a date when she's leaving. Is that what we're doing?
Right. That's what I thought. Yes.
Yeah.
So, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous.
Mr. Bell.
Now, the third is subject to some discussion because it is contingent upon the current director's reaction to the communication.
Right.
So, I think...
I think we need to have something in place just because having, like, look, even George said earlier, I mean, trying to bring two committees together sometimes is... tedious, yeah. And sometimes it takes a small period of time.
Well, then what I would say is this. I would say let us extend to the superintendent the authority to appropriately judge whether Ms. Cosgrove should be put on retainer for a period of a month, the contingency being the reaction of the current director to the communication. That would be my suggestion. I don't know if that needs to be in the form of a motion. I don't think it does. I think it's just an expression of confidence in the superintendent to make that judgment.
I think in this particular instance, I think it would be important for us to at least include that cap, that $160 cap.
Yeah.
I'd rather we do that based on the 60-hour month and the other individual based on a 15-hour month at $80.
Mm-hmm.
So I would prefer however we phrase that motion, we cap it at that.
A month, you think about?
Yeah.
And that certainly, obviously, was my expectation. I was not going to pursue acquiring the services if, in fact, I had a special education. So
yeah. I have a question. The $80 an hour.
Hold on, one second. We have a motion. I'd like to do this in a motion in a second. So if we have a second on that. And then we have a discussion.
That would be my motion, sir.
That would be your motion? You have
a
sit.
Well, I really did not phrase mine as a motion. I don't think, Bob, you did as well.
That's
what I did either.
I'm making mine as the motion.
Okay, you did.
Yeah.
So your motion would be to retain Ms. Cosgrove for...
Well, to allow the superintendent to enter into a contract with a cap of $100.
If necessary.
Not right. Even with this individual. With an individual.
Right.
Well, no, they named that individual.
I did.
Mr. Bello, did you?
Yeah, but I didn't make a motion.
Okay.
So you're just saying...
I'm just... You actually disauthorized... You actually disauthorized me. I didn't really mention a name, just simply indicated. I just provided an example.
Okay. Are you authorizing the superintendent with the cap?
With a cap.
Okay. We have a motion. A second?
Second.
Victor, yes. Discussion.
The candidate that is going to that will be receiving $80 an hour for the out-of-district children, she's currently an employee of our district?
Retired.
She's retired. Okay.
That would be a separate motion.
If you're suggesting the superintendent has the discretion to make that recommendation, obviously contingent upon that, I think you can leave it
at the 160. Yeah.
Not mentioning names, I know that, and that is if you want to establish the financial parameters, I understand how I need to, what limits I have as it relates. I just put that out there.
Yeah, I don't think it would be a second one because you're capping it no matter what.
Right.
So.
Is it appropriate for me to comment at this
chart? Yes.
Once again, it boggles my mind. We're talking about a person who's probably got 30 years experience in the district, probably knows many of the special needs students, knows the entire special needs faculty, has broad experience. I'm going to pay her $80 an hour. We're going to bring somebody in from outside the district on a consulting basis who knows nothing about our faculty, nothing about our students, and is a retired special ed director. I'm going to pay her $160 an hour.
She's not retired. She has 3 part-time jobs, according to her resume.
She's working for a consulting firm. She's probably acting in various districts and is going to be a part-time special ed consultant for us 15 hours a week.
But I would say, Rick, and Bob, correct me if I'm wrong, He is not saying he needs to be that person. For example, you mentioned an individual in the community. I think that name should go to the superintendent to make a determination. Well, all we're doing is giving him the authority to cover that 30-day period with the cap. We're not saying that that would be the person.
And, so, I don't disagree with that. I'd be happy to take a look at it.
No, I think you should take a look at that.
Well, I mean, even if you're, correct me if I'm wrong, you're saying that part of that service was going to be covered by an individual that you did name at a much lower rate. And that's one of the reasons why I asked. Is there a reason why those two pieces have to be separate, or could one person
that individual at the time we engaged in the discussion was not engaged in the looking at the full capacity of what would be required of a special ed director. I do think she has some real solid competencies and was my coordinator at the middle school and certainly has a very solid background. But I'm not opposed to pursuing individuals beyond this individual. I simply wanted to assure people I had a short-term strategy. I'm not opposed to that. Rick, you want to share that information with me? It may be the same individual we're talking about, but if it's somebody else, I certainly will do that as I await to see what transpires with that current SPED director.
Because that's my understanding of the motion is we're basically giving him the power to hire whoever he wants at the best price that's going to run the district in the best way for special ed because we're in an emergency situation.
Until it fulfills.
Right.
And that may not possibly be until October, depending on the reaction we get from the
Mr. Chair, I'd like to amend that motion. I'd like to make a motion that we'll give the superintendent the discretion to spend up to $3,600 a week for the next 4 weeks for a short-term period, which is basically the 160 plus 80 times 15, which is $3,600. I don't believe we should be making this an unlimited thing. I think we need to come back in 1 month and to see what kind of candidates we have and move forward. And if we need another additional time, then we authorize more time. At this point, I'll support up to 1 month, 4 weeks at $3,600 each week.
Each week?
It's basically
14 more.
It's basically 100. It's the 160 plus the 80
times 15.
It's $3,600.
Together.
Yeah. So for the short period, so if it's 1, 2, 3 people, whoever we need, we're giving him a cap, a dollar amount cap to work with for the next 4 weeks. That's my motion, my amendment.
Okay.
For 4 weeks.
So you actually did give him more money than his original numbers?
No, he asked for 15 hours a week.
Right.
15 a month.
15 a month? Oh, I apologize.
That's
my position. That's 15. In that case, you had mentioned 15 a week, 60 hours, 75 hours.
15 hours a month?
Yes.
And 20 hours, 20 hours a week?
Yes, he did.
For the other person. That's why I said that's about 18
hours.
Yeah, 18, that's why I said 18
hours a week.
So how many hours are we talking here? Because I'm going to...
Mr. Furtado, can you give us the figure, please?
I need the figure.
How about that? Why would we pay him?
$75. I was basing on the Dave Holden model, except that we had
$3,000.
So why don't I amend the slide? Is it easier for me to withdraw or amend the motion?
No.
I will withdraw my amendment. Just so you can just make one complete motion and withdraw and let's keep it clean.
I just want to think, we're kind of playing around. Why don't just let him do what he wants to do? If you put all these caps and requirements, we're talking about right now, it could be the base of the situation where the director could be gone in 11 weeks. And if we put all these parameters on it, he can't find someone. Just leave it up to give him the power to do what he needs to do to run the district the best for the kids.
Because it's our responsibility to give him a set amount of dollars.
He knows what the finances is. He has a director of finance. I think they can figure it out.
Personally, I would like to, and not put just 1 month on it, because of a joint meeting. It looks like we'll be having a joint meeting, at the beginning of the month of October. So if we could have a 2 month period, we can always address this issue and extend it if it will be, as we see fit. Because if we don't, and we only have a 1 month cap on it, we don't have a meeting, we're running into some major issues.
I
Mr. Tata?
Okay, let's go back.
Hold on one second.
If you're going to structure it that way, then why don't you just approve the authority through a week after your next meeting and perpetuate that? So you can cut it off at every meeting you maybe you want.
Why do we want to put such a constraint on? Why don't we just leave it up to him? If we don't like what he did, we can address it at the next meeting, but let him, because, I mean, it's an important position, and we're screwing around with days and dollars and months, and just give him the authority to do what he needs to do to run the district, and if we don't like what he did, we can address it another day.
Yeah, yeah.
All right, well, we have a motion in a second. Do we want to withdraw that?
I'm going to withdraw that motion.
Yes. And withdraw the second, Mr. Ravello?
Yes.
Okay.
So I'm going to make a motion that we authorize up to $3,000 a week for the contractual services to cover special education. Up to the, what's the date of our October meeting?
It's not.
So.
Could, before we continue this motion, I mean, I would have to agree with Kelly and say that I think we give him the authority. I think he's already heard from us. He knows what the constraints are. I think Mr. Furtado knows extremely well what the constraints are with the budget. And I think if they came to us in the middle of the year and said, well, we need to stop moving money around because of the situation, I think they would hear it very loud and clear that that's not what we wanted. And I think there would be repercussions on that, extreme repercussions on that.
My concern is that we get a lot of pushback from the community on the dollars that we spend, and that's why I want to make sure that it was pretty clear and specific on the extent of that. So it's no reflection on whether the superintendent does or does not know what he needs for that particular person, but I just want to make sure that the community is aware that, you know, we're watching the dollars too. So that's my intention and my reasoning behind that dollar amount.
So we have a motion that for $3,000 to give the superintendent
on a weekly basis.
On a weekly basis. Motion. Do I hear a second?
Okay. Second.
Any further discussion? No. Nope. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Chair votes aye as well. Unanimous. All right.
So do we have a similar motion on the regional committee?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
All right. Motion made by Ms. White, seconded by Ms. Gagliotti. Any further discussion?
There was no date on that.
Yes.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yep. There's a reason. We'll meet again.
So what was it? It was 3,000?
Just a cap of 3,000.
And are you comfortable with that cap? That you can do what you need to do with that cap?
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And I vote no. So it's 5-1.
How soon can you sit down with her?
I will be talking to Mr. Pierce at the end of this meeting with Mr. Medeiros, and either tomorrow or Monday, we will be figuring something out. Thursday. Yeah. All right, moving on. Joint tech position. Mr. Medeiros. Let's kind of back into this. We've had discussions on both the Kid 8 and the region side of the joint tech position and Tech Edge on the regional side has given a recommendation. K to A side was looking for a technical person and was looking at possibly putting a tech position as a joint. Since we are together tonight, we've had a discussion on both sides. Mr. Pierce and I felt that it was perfect to have this discussion now and to see which way we're moving forward. So, Mr. Medeiros, any recommendation on the joint position?
Susie, you had asked me about the Somerset group, and I had a great conversation with Pierce, so we had a chance to meet the region. Certainly, where I think much was contingent upon the Tech Edge recommendations. I think there was a lot of there's been a lot of discussion about holding off on that. I think you have two scenarios here. I had a lengthy discussion with my central office staff. Dr. Smith was also part of that process. Mr. Neckrass, Mr. Matano, myself, as late as this morning in relation. I think you basically have two scenarios, and we recommend them in this order. One, that we look to hire a shared staff member. Mr. Neckrass had provided a job description for that. I know it's a little different than what, or maybe somewhat significantly different than what the Tech Ed description was. They posted an example of that. But the first scenario, first option, and my recommendation is that there be a shared technical support specialist position posted, and that would add to the existing IT department. And that would obviously work for both the regional high school and K-8. The second scenario, if in fact, and again, it's done in this order, that would be our recommendation from a central office perspective. The second option would be consistent with what TechEdge had recommended, which there'd be a separate and distinct position solely for the regional high school. If you're going to do that, our recommendation would be that, in fact, the two existing IT technicians be assigned exclusively to the K-8 five schools. So if you were going to explore that, the division would be one for the high school, that new position posted, and the other two would be assigned to the five schools. To add to that, it's reminding me, the description or at that high school position would in fact, like the current positions, report directly to the director of technology in collaboration with the principal, as opposed to the posting as it was described, which was a direct reporting to the principal and made no mention of the director of technology. So Susan and Mr. Pearson, in that order, we discussed those two scenarios, and our recommendation would be the continued shared support of the IT tech person for a variety of reasons, and certainly Mr. Neckrass can answer any specific questions, but based on at least what the Somerset board had asked me to, that's my recommendation at this time. I can go into more detail, but I'm assuming the board wants to ask, engage dialogue as it relates.
I mean, I think, speaking, from at least the K-8 Tech Task Force perspective, I think we certainly identified the need, and I think the discussion and the vote that K-8 can teach up was representative of that need. Frankly, again, this comes down to a matter of Mr. Neckrass's ability and our trust in his ability to manage those folks and to put them where they need to be. I would prefer, personally, that we share. I think it's better with the technology merging. I think at this point, we're trying to plug the leaks in the high school technology-wise. In a couple of years, it'll be where it needs to be. And I think K-8, from our perspective, we've had fantastic support from the community in getting the Wi-Fi up and the new technology in. I know we're going to be deploying the iPads in a test pilot program at the middle school. So I think that sharing of that information, I know that we're going to be doing our own tech assessment K-8. So I think it's probably in the best interest of both districts to share all of those positions unless somebody feels those differently.
My concern from our perspective is one of the recommendations on Tech Edge was for us to put together a committee and to go over certain items that we need to do with the high school level. My concern with hiring a position is two concerns. One is the budget. We always have a budget for this year. That's going to obviously be another item that's unbudgeted for this year. We got a special ed director that we may be hiring, which may cost more money. And when we look at technology in the high school, there's a lot of things we're looking at doing, professional development, stuff like that. So I'd like, from my perspective, from the region, it's to let our task committee decide what's the priorities we need to do to best affect the students through the teachers, through the technology. So from my perspective, and I would like from the director to give us sort of an overview of how much time is spent at the K through 8 for the assistants he has now, how much time is spent at the high school, is it 50-50, is it 80-20, so we can get an idea of where the technology and where the services are going now in the department and see where we need to go for the future. So from my perspective, I'd like to hear from our sort of our committee in regards to what we need to do at the high school, which is best. Do we need to put that money really this year into professional development and into buying computers and equipment that would impact the students the best, or do we need to hire a person full-time or part-time or share? I'm just not, my perspective is not ready to have a joint position yet. I'd like to hear from our committee that Tech Ed recommended it for us to put up and then go forward. My position on that.
I tend to agree with George. I think we need our task force in place to look at the situation and try to figure out what the best way is to manage the limited resources that we have. We need someone with skills related to the network and various other issues that are set forth in the job description. And I think if we bring this person on board, it will free up time of the existing staff to focus on the middle school and the elementary school level. And but from my perspective, I think we need that input in a more collaborative discussion about exactly how this would work. No one's looking to kind of avoid the current organization, although at some point down the line, it may be necessary to look at what the needs are of the two separate districts and address them. But for the time being, I think we can work effectively together. But I'm not in favor of going forward with hiring for either position at this point in time.
Can I mention one more thing? I forgot to mention is one of the things I think we need to look at. And you know, my eyes are open a lot at the last meeting we were at. I think, is it Mr. Gauthier?
Yes.
I mean, he spoke last time. He did a tremendous amount of work at the high school, from my understanding, for no cost. And to me, that's a type of business community development you want to get. I mean, that is a phenomenal. I mean, I didn't understand half of it because I'm not computer literate.
Mr. Gauthier and his company has also done tremendous work in the four elementary and the middle school. K-8 over the past 2 years too. So
I mean, so he should be recognized for that. But that's also kind of a community development you want to build with businesses that can save us money, but can do a phenomenal job and help out the students and the teachers and the faculty as well. So I just wanted to mention that as well. Is we always don't have to pay for things and hire people. We can bridge the community and get their involvement and expertise to help us out along as well.
George. What Mr. Gauthier does for our schools, all six schools, is unbelievable, and we're very grateful. And I really believe we should do something eventually, and we will, to acknowledge him. And I'm sure he'll be the first to say, no, I don't want that. See, and there he is. He's already saying it. But, you know, our task force in the K through 8, which is led by our two representatives and also a few wonderful parents and, you know, a lot of help of the community, they came to us and said, listen, we need more tasks. And first started off with Mr. Gauthier. I heard that, and then out of the blue, he came and introduced himself while I was sitting at my desk, and he says, listen, you really do need another person on. You really do. They're strapped. And so we did make, you know, I understand this is one of those rare occasions that we're ahead of the region because your task force is being formed. We already have a task force. We know our needs are in the K through 8. And that's why our committee voted 5-0 to hire a new IT person. Because we need, we see the need. The only problem when the motion was made, it was, okay, let's hire another person as long as the region agrees to. Now, I fully respect that you're not ready, we, as part of the region, are not ready to make that move yet, as I mentioned a couple of meetings ago. But when I left our meeting, reality kicked in, and I started figuring, well, how can the K-8 do it without the region? And it was really quick, and I'm sure everyone read it in the newspaper. We're paying currently 1.3% of, we're paying for 1.3 of the two men. If we add a third person, we are now paying 1.95 of the three men. It just does not make sense for the K-8 not to spend another $2,500 and have two dedicated men in the K-8 issues. And I also liked the part where I was at the listening to the Tech Edge, when they said you can ask for help of other districts. So if we have our two staff members and our director feels that we really have an issue at the high school, we really could use support, and then he, because these gentlemen work for the K-8, could put in a request through the superintendent to the school committee to allocate X amount of days to help the region. All we would ask in return is if we're having a major issue in the K-8, to do the same. Hey, Ray needs extra, then the region would allocate a couple of men or a man time to, you know, as a good partnership as the Tech Edge recommended. But for us to even consider hiring a third person as a joint doesn't make any financial sense for the K-8. We have our needs as well. You know, our K-8 have our needs. We have a, you know, we're at the high school, we're very fortunate. We're gonna have a state-of-the-art facility. But we need to be prepared in the K-8 before that high school is ready. And I don't believe the way our task force has come up to us many times, we need to hire a new person. We need to hire a new person. For us to say, no, let's not hire another person, is prolonging the good work that our task force has come up with a recommendation. So that's where I'm having mixed feelings. Personally, looking at other school districts, as I did a little research, other school districts, three is not even enough for a size district. Personally, I hate to say this, as a regional member, we don't need one, we need two. I think we need at least to start off with two at the K-8, two at the region. Because we're working bare bones, and our community has invested a lot of money in our technology. For us to start working with a skeleton crew, it needs to be put to an end. So I understand, but technically, my motion today is to hire a third person, but really to keep two men solely in the K-8.
And I think, you know, and I appreciate that, Victor. That makes a good point. You know, when we met, and we continue to meet, Mr. Gauthier is a member as well as some other folks, we did not meet in a vacuum. It was not, it's only the middle school and the four elementary schools. I mean, Mr. Nekras was at our meetings and on the committee and talked to us about that. He gave us a full list of all the work orders that they get on a daily basis, on a monthly basis. So it wasn't as if we weren't looking at the high school at all. I mean, clearly we identified the need for these shared positions. It's just a matter of, do we say two staffers solely worked for K-8, and one staffer works at the high school, and then Mr. Nekras covers both? I mean, I don't know.
I think, yep.
What are...
We can look at K-8 as being kind of ahead of the curve because you have your technology task force. And another side, the region has actually done their assessment, which I think you are looking to do, so you haven't done that yet. But we've done this assessment, and the recommendation of the assessment doesn't exactly match what your task force has done. So I think for us it makes sense to wait to get a group together to look at this. Perhaps give your team time to go ahead and do your assessment. Because I don't want to spend money on a shared position if that's not the best thing for both districts. I think we need a better look at what's going forward. I mean, we all agree that we need to look at it, but I don't think we jump into a joint position just for adding another person. I think we need to look at what those tasks are and what's the best way to move forward.
Could I first? kind of sitting on both. I think the need is there. We know, even in the region and in the K-8, the need is there for that position. What I would like for us to do is, because the region is putting, as Julie was saying, is, you know, we'll be putting a task force together. I would like the assessment done on the K-8 side. And also what I'd like to see is, from the administration piece, is a plan, whether it's a 2-year, 3-year, 5-year plan out of how this is all gonna work and where do we need to get to? Because I'm looking at other districts, and other districts are having 2-3 people, technology specialists, in each school. I mean, we saw the tech task force for the building committee. So in Norwood, they have 12 members on the technology team. You know, so it, you know, I think as both districts, I think we're a little behind the curve, and I believe we know the need is there. I just don't think right now, I think we can table this position for a little bit more time until we get that full assessment, we get the task force, and we can even merge the two task force at some point and say, okay, kind of where are we at? How can we make sure that the youth that are going from the elementary and middle school, are they prepared for the high school? And also sitting down with Berkeley as well and making sure we're all kind of on the same page, because we are one community. So,
have we developed a task force yet, the region?
That was one of the first things that we've been told as of last week. So at our next meeting, we're going to try to.
Okay. If I could just for a minute, I hear what people are saying. I'm not buying it. I don't agree with the fact that we know that we need another position. I don't know that. I know there are serious concerns that I have, 2 pages of questions. And unfortunately, I did get to see the tech edge. But none of those questions have been answered to my satisfaction. I don't think it's a case of lack of bodies. I wish we were like those very wealthy districts, but we're not. But if you compare us to districts that are comparable to us, I work in a district that has one director, technology director, and 2 tech guys out in the buildings. Same number of buildings, same number of computer stations. We probably have more iPads and laptop carts, and it's effective. It's run very well. They're making it work. So I'm not convinced that we need to get your body. I have serious concerns. I think that we need to get that task force together. I think we need to take a hard look at why we're in this position that we are. I'm speaking just solely of the region. Because I don't think it's a lack of bodies. I really don't. That's not what I've read. That's not my understanding. I was extremely upset with the report itself. And I still have very serious concerns, so I wouldn't spend 1 cent on a position until I knew that was truly what was needed. I think we need to evaluate why we're here, what got us in this position, why is the high school in the condition that it's in, because I'm sorry, but those things are unacceptable. What I read in that report is completely unacceptable. Completely. I can't even fathom a reason how we got to that position. So, not only would I not be supporting hiring another body at this point, but I would like further evaluation on how this even happened, why we're here. I mean, I feel like I've been played for a fool because we've been supporting technology, we've been pushing to get the technology in the building, and we're being told that the building's old and you can't access it. No, I don't feel that's the case anymore. And I don't like being played for a fool, and I feel that after reading this, that's what's been happening. So I'm looking forward to our next meeting when we do develop that task force, because I think there are some concerns that really need to be addressed at this point.
Don?
Just going to speak from the perspective of experience and the task force for more than a year. This group is made up of a number of individuals, 8 to 12 of whom have developed expertise in the area of technology and technology application. This gentleman included, Dave Gauthier, number of teachers, educational professionals who have worked as integration specialists, technology assistants and aides. We've had faculty members do an extensive survey of faculty on needs K-8. We've done through the Mr. Nickgrass a very comprehensive evaluation of our hardware needs, time study spent on availability of staff to integrate technology, to upgrade technology, to repair technology. Those studies have all been done. I will tell you this, definitively, confidently, and with no at all trepidation, and with no ambiguity, there is a need K-8 for another body. We are behind at that level. Our kids on a daily basis are at a disadvantage because we are not using technology extensively enough and adequately enough to support the learning process. One of the reasons is we do not have the technology support and integration support to do so. I say that unequivocally, and you can bring in all the experts that you want to study it, but I'm absolutely convinced that that is the situation. I respect thoroughly your opinions. I'm waiting until you get more information at the high school level, the regional level. However, the time frame concerns me. As every day goes by, our kids at the elementary level lose. I am totally supportive of another staff member being hired now and get in those buildings immediately to bring our teachers up to speed, to bring our equipment up to speed, and to enhance the learning process of our elementary school children who are at a distinct disadvantage in Somerset. I'm embarrassed to say it, because we don't have enough support. And that is a fact. We delay any further, we are delaying the educational process. And I will tell you folks that it's incumbent upon us to take a strong stand on this, because the need is very, very, very evident and proven. And that is my position on it, and I will not alter from that position. Although I respect you folks at the regional level, I think you need to do your studies. I think you need to be absolutely convinced before you spend any more money in that regard. But K-8 folks, we need to move now. That's our responsibility.
I think tonight was...
I don't see our regional decision making...
No,
minimizing the need for the K-8. No. I just see us looking at a new building and where we are right now, but I definitely see them very separate.
Tonight was to discuss whether it would be a joint tech position, and I think at this moment it's not, and I think on the K-8 side, as you mentioned, Mr. Bell, we know the need that's there, yep. What the work, the hard work that all those individuals have done. So I think we bring that forward to the next meeting. And then
unfortunately, with all due respect, Mr. Chair, it does affect, because I agree that we do need another tech in a K-8, but I do not agree that we need 2.3% at the K-8. And if we hire someone new, it does affect the region, because I will not support a full employee of the K-8 purposely only, because now we're paying at a 2.3. I don't believe we can even consider that at a region level.
Well, that's why I mentioned that I would like to see a plan in place where if there's going to be a organizational structure change on the K-8 and the region side, I think that something appropriate would be put in place, you know, from the administration and be brought forward saying we are changing the structure because of the needs are not similar and we need to start changing things around. I wouldn't want to like take any kind of vote tonight because we don't know what that organizational structure. I'd like to hear from Mr. Medeiros and his team if there is going to, I mean, he kind of gave us a couple of different options, but.
Well, I'm very comfortable with one of those options. And I think that's the pot, you know, one of those options is exactly where I think the K-8 needs to go towards. I thought that was, you know, when I whispered in your ear to make sure that this is on the agenda for today, is because we already, remember, when we voted, it was before school had begun. So let's think about this. We are already, when did we make this motion? Well, the reason why we made this motion is so we can get our schools ready, up and running. we already lost that summer month to put that posting out.
But Victor, if the regional school committee is very interested in waiting until we get our task force to make that decision.
This is the part where I'm very concerned. What do we do? Is the K through 8 continue to hold? Whatever decision we make, I don't want you to hear after our next meeting that the K through 8 decide we're going to go with our own two. I'm just letting you know that this is a concern, and I don't know how the rest of the committee members feel, but the longer we continue to wait is, before you know, your school is up, and now we're behind. Sometimes it's summer, you know, we're in a dual role.
Right, but the thing is that we're not, I personally, and I think we've had other people express the fact that we're not ready to spend that money yet until we do another step.
And if we do option two, the region is not ready to hire that person yet. So we're not, as both districts as a joint, and if we are gonna have that separation, then we need to make sure that on both sides, jointly, we're ready to make that separation on the technology piece. And the region's just not ready yet. So I understand, I hear your concern.
I also hear.
So we might, as K to 8, we might have to bite the bullet for a little bit and hire somebody for a month or two and pay that extra point three until the region is ready to say, okay, we're ready to hire, and this is what we're hiring, and then make that separation.
You can't, because once you hire one more person than the region, it's bad enough. I've been saying this since day one. Our percentages are wrong. That I don't believe they benefit the K-8. I've been saying that since day one. Now you're saying maybe we should hire some extra people in the K-8, when then I don't know how many hours currently our staff is working. I asked a few months ago from our technical, how many work orders were at one school and how many work orders was at another school. Out of the 1,700 work orders supposedly we had, there was only accounted for 800. And it was amazing. That 800 was a perfect 65-35%. I have a hard time believing that the K-8 does not have more issues than the high school sometimes, because we're five buildings versus one. I have a hard time. I also have a hard time when I hear teachers, and I'm sure half of you have heard this, when teachers say, we don't see a technology person in the K-8 as often as the high school people do. I'm sorry, I'm a K-8 representative as well as the region now. I have to worry about the K-8 students as well. I don't have the glory of sitting back and waiting. This waiting time for the K-8 has come. Why are we continuing to meet with the task force, with them coming in with, you know what's gonna happen to our task force eventually? You know what? Nothing's getting done with it.
No. But on the K-8 side, we can take action and vote to put somebody there. But tonight we were talking about a joint tech position, whether it was, so if, as the region has stated, you know, you're part of the region, we're not ready to do that yet because of the assessment, and we need to put a task force together. On the K-8 side, we can still move forward and still hire a person just for the four elementary and the middle school.
I can't support it. But that's the part I'm telling you. I cannot support it, because if I hire an additional person, right now, I don't think the time spent with our two members are fairly between the both regions. To ask for another person in the K-8 is going to skew that even further.
Can I make a motion that we decide that we table this until, table the discussion between the joint tech positions on the agenda until after our task force has met and makes a recommendation?
Okay, motion made by Mr. Kelly and seconded by Mrs. Gagliardi. Is there any discussion? Okay, the absence of discussion on the regional committee, all those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
And the chair votes aye. Opposed?
No.
5-1.
Whew. Next.
Well, I think the K-8 needs to just let you know that the next meeting, I will be making a recommendation that the K through 8 hire a two solely personnel for the K through 8, as the task force has requested numerous times and that we've supported in the past. So
we'll have that.
If you could have that on the agenda.
Absolutely.
Right, 8:30.
Moving on, Mr. Medeiros, food service. Would you like to go into detail, please?
Yes, Susan, Mr. Pierce, I'd like to give an update and actually turn over much of the presentation to Mr. Furtado in relation to food service, give an update as to the SE activity, RFP, a variety of tasks as it relates to the opening of school. We did have a smooth start to the opening of school today. I provide you with a moment, some staffing. We opened up K to actually grades 1 to 9 today. The rest of the high school starts tomorrow, and kindergarten starts as well in orientation session tomorrow and Monday, so we'll see the numbers there reflect that we're providing lunch services. So the DESC last two representatives concluded activities this afternoon, leaving Mr. Todd and I kind of a closing exit, kind of an interview as it relates to some ongoing activity. I'll turn it over to Mr. Furtado maybe to go through some of the details and answer some of the questions, and I may make some additional comments in closing before we open it up to the boards.
Regarding the RFP, we had to adjust the release date because of some advertising and central register issues. So it's being released on the 12th. The pre-bid meeting would take place on the 19th. No other dates would be shifted. The RFP would still be due October 5th. We would still hope to have presentations to the Joint Committee either on the 11th or the 18th of October. And again, if necessary, have a final decision on November 1st at the scheduled meeting, but preferably for a decision after the presentations. No questions?
Lost
a week in the fire.
Time frame is, this will be issued on the 12th of September, and we'll be having a meeting on the 11th of October.
There is I believe it's a regional meeting scheduled for the 11th. I believe the Somerset Board has a meeting on the 18th. So either of those could be modified to be a joint meeting to the get your presentations by the respondents who are scheduled to respond by the 5th. Either of those meetings, you would certainly have a full understanding of the financial side of it, and they would present the kind of programmatic side of it at the meeting that night. You would see and taste the food, understand their kind of philosophical approach from a nutritional perspective. So you would basically have all of the ingredients, if you will, to make a decision if you were so inclined. Otherwise, you certainly have a fallback on November 1st with already a scheduled joint meeting to do so as well. So you have kind of two bites of the apple if you need it.
Did you say they provide tasting?
Yes, sir.
If any of us wanted to do a site visit with any of the
proposals,
it's a relatively short period between the due date on October 5th and the meeting on October 11th.
Yes.
But it's perhaps if we knew.
They all have sites nearby that act as hosts for these purposes. Alabama is one of them, by the way.
Well, if you just keep in mind, if there's some way to, if we know that people are likely to bid, maybe you could be in discussion with them and arrange a site visit before the 5th of October.
We could do that. We've had proactive approaches by Exo, Whitson's, and Charles. The only other major player who has not contacted us first, we've been Airmark, so we'll probably just make them aware the RFP is available and send it to them to get to them to propose, but I can assure you that the other three will be proposing.
And we'll get the list of schools that they're already working on.
Again, they have sites that they would direct you to. Usually they have bigger sites to show you kind of full scale of operations. They would also be required by the RFP to provide four references. So you'd have multiple opportunities to plug into operations and see how they're doing. Right, current operations. As you know, the state was here again at the beginning of spring for a routine audit. As we have reported, the findings were not terribly positive. It was a follow-up independent audit by an audit firm that does state end of year reports, a very deep firm, deep in state experience. A draft of that was received yesterday. It's terribly consistent with DESE findings, although they did not have access to the DESE findings. It certainly speaks to some issues across the board, not isolated. DESE, in the context of that audit, had offered some follow-up work, which was just completed, kind of focused on storage and inventory of food, conditions of equipment, and kitchens. That work was also concerning. So we're at a point now where, you know, you have multiple points of input from multiple sources, and again, I think I expressed this very early on prior to even bringing the RFP to you, that conditions are not where they need to be. There's a significant amount of work that needs to be done.
And I can just add, certainly interject, the DESE is well aware of the activities we're engaged, is very, quite frankly, pleased to the extent that we're taking necessary steps, recognize that we have a long way to go, fully aware and support the RFP and the exploration of that option as it relates, especially obviously recognizing the significant commitment that we would need to make. Regardless, the two individuals left Mark's office today. We sat in there and talked about some things that we can do in the coming months. They provided a training to all cafeteria staff, with the exception of, I think, one individual at that session on Tuesday. It was about a two-hour session, a little over 2 hours. They were most receptive to that. We're actually looking at the John Stalker Institute and a few other state-endorsed groups and group to provide some professional development in the coming months as we kind of bridge that gap between making the determination, long-term. Obviously, we're providing lunches. Everything is going through Mr. Furtado's office now, the three cafeteria managers. And I say the three cafeteria managers, we have a cafeteria manager at North, one at the middle school, and one at the high school. The one at North oversees the distribution to the satellite, three other elementary schools. Significant concerns, and I shared that correspondence to both boards in relation to some action being taken. And yet, both members that were here, and there was actually a team of up to five, I think, at one point, feel that we're taking the necessary steps and to get to where we need to be, and we're a long way away, but we're encouraged, provided a lot of guidance and support. Very often it's in the state, or there are people are critical of the state not working, including some of my colleagues, in a supportive way around audits and so forth. That's not been the case here. They've tried to engage and provide as much training as possible to our staff. They're working with us. They recognize that the management at central office is, and for that matter, at the building level, with principals and managers, is working cooperatively with them. And so the RFP's in place. Mark's alluded to that. We have several months of obviously the school year. We have menus to take a look at, nutritional guidelines and rules and regulations. We don't have a system in place in relation to computerizing that piece, and so that's going to be somewhat delayed as we look at and explore this option. I'm confident that we will oversee this and work positively and make some gains,
I was talking to a couple of board members in my goal session today about some things that we're doing specifically as it relates to receiving goods as they come in, contacting vendors, things that need to be done now, quite frankly, as we prepare appropriate meals for our kids and staff, and also obviously as we explore other options. But I'd be remiss if I didn't put it up on the agenda. I can't obviously get into personnel matters as it relates, but I wanted to assure both boards last week, and I assure you once again in open session today, that we'll take necessary steps to ensure that our kids are provided with a healthy, safe meal and an environment that's conducive to that, and that all the employees that are engaged in that process are provided with necessary training. One, for example, the SRC training that you've heard about. We have four individuals that are attending that training next week. We've identified three. We're actually identifying a fourth, the three food service managers, and one other to be determined employee replacing another individual who was initially going to attend. But we have four representatives going to be to receive that initial training, which I believe is next 10th, September 10th. So that's only next week. So we will accelerate and kind of keep you updated in the coming months as we provide this in addition to the RFP information. It continues to be on our radar. I've had Mark was at all the sites today, I think, everywhere. He was surprised because I had similar conversations, and he's wondering in a small community how we didn't cross paths. But I also had conversations with food service managers as it relates to needs. And so together we are working with building level people to ensure that we're up and running. And like I said, we started our grades 1 and 9. We provided lunch and food for those students in four elementary schools, middle school, and high school. It was somewhat abbreviated because we just had the freshmen there today. But we are prepared for tomorrow when the rest of the student population comes to the high school. So Mark didn't mean to jump in, but that's been kind of the joint effort as it relates to some support staff. I'd be happy to specifically answer any questions that board members had. This was simply more of an update to keep you informed that although we are exploring other options, we recognize the immediate need to address nutritional guidelines and rules and regulations, and I think we're taking the necessary steps. And the state literally left here today saying they probably wouldn't be back for some time based on their schedule, but that we could correspond with them in relation to requests that we had if we had some difficulty with vendors and those types of things. And ultimately, I think they would be back in the spring is what they would do as a follow-up visit.
What are the roles of the managers, the food service managers, the three of them, for the nutritional guidelines, the inventory, inspection of, the cleanliness and everything? What are their roles?
They run the kitchen. They literally run the kitchen. They're assigning people the tasks, they're making sure things are clean, they're making sure meals are made, they're making sure cash is handled, and they're making sure that the cash reflects the meal is made. Menu planning, what you would call back of the house process, like inventory control, they certainly play a role. I mean, they're serving the food, they're receiving the food, they're putting the food in the freezer. The food service director ought to be managing those kind of bigger issues that, essentially certifying that your menus meet the nutritional guidelines. There are incentives, financial incentives, in terms of your reimbursement from the federal government to meeting the new nutritional guidelines. So it would be the role of the food service manager to make sure we hit those incentives, to make sure that the stock is rotated, to make sure the inventory counts are accurate. I think Mr. Machado works in a production environment or partly. Food service is production of meals, and the meals produced ought to reflect relief of inventory and goods purchased. And in a perfect world, you have very, very little inventory. That's not necessarily the responsibility of the kitchen manager. She's simply reporting up, here are the meals that we served. There ought to be a big view saying, because you're getting the satellite schools as well, and even theoretically district-wide inventory position, because you're getting inventory in various places. And if all of a sudden the kids at the middle school decide they don't like cheese, and the cheese inventory's building up, you can relieve it. You know, it doesn't have to stay at the middle school. So, you know, the management of essentially your resources really kind of drives the success of the program, and that probably wasn't optimal here.
I just had a couple of things. One, regarding that meeting Tuesday, I'd like to get a confirmation on just one, because it was my understanding that there were several staff members across the food service staff who were not informed of that meeting. So if you could just confirm that number, because that's...
Yeah, 22 people out of 28 show up.
Okay, yeah, but I mean, again, what I'd like to do is just to make sure, my understanding was that the people who weren't there, with maybe the exception of one or two, were not reached. So I just want to make sure that, you know, that the contact information is up to date and that we actually do communicate, because if there was certain things that went on Tuesday, if, you know, there were trainings or anything like that, I want to make sure
that at that point the communication was through the food service director, and what that event entailed was two things. It was a, you know, real top level review from the employee's perspective on what the processes were, and then pushback as to what the appropriate processes should be. So,
I guess I just want to make sure that whoever wasn't contacted, you do make sure you contact them the next time, and that once they start,
we're going to handle that.
Which I'm assuming was today, that we get them whatever
training. That was totally ad hoc. That was, again, DSE came in on Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, of last week, to kind of do this follow-up work, and at the end of the week said, we need to meet the staff before school starts. So there was literally a 48-hour window to contact people and make them aware that they needed to be here. The one person the superintendent was referred to was on vacation, so she was definitely not contacted because she wasn't here. She wasn't, you know, she didn't have access to her means of communication. And that may have been the case with some other people, but this was not a planned event. This was we're at the point where we feel pretty strongly that it's important that a group get together and have at least, toes wet and some of the things that need to be discussed.
We institute one call, we contact our staff. I just want to make sure that, you know,
future interactions is going to come from this office, from one of us, and I couldn't agree more. In fact, I know some of the DESD staff met with some of those individuals who weren't present Tuesday today to kind of review some things, and talked about the fact that those individuals missed out on those things and tried to at least provide some of that guidance and direction.
And the other question I had was I managed to make it to all the schools this morning, and just as of the, I mean, we don't have a very varied menu at this point, but one of the meals wasn't available today, and I'm assuming that has to do with the supply chain issue. Are we expecting that for the next weeks,
we're trying to address, Mark, you can speak to this. We certainly had some issues in relation to what commodities came in, what material, what we had, what limitations we had based on, that's typically handled by the food service director. We're working on making sure that we have adequate meals actually for tomorrow, that's set, and then long term, kind of expanding upon that, we've addressed that.
Purchasing cycles will happen weekly, sometimes twice a week. So, where you see deficiencies in terms of again inventory position, that will always be a short term issue. The problem with the start of school is there was a perception on availability of inventory that was quite off. So I would expect there to be some food issues through the middle of next week until we can replenish through purchase.
That's a couple questions.
Yeah.
Is the problems that the DESE encountered, are they a school problem? Are they a K-8 problem with all the schools? Is it a problem with the region and all the schools? So is it isolated to a school, or is it the K-8, or is it the district? Is it the entire school, two districts together?
It's both and all, and certainly not limited to any location. Process issue. So the process affects all buildings, all grade levels, all employees.
And who's responsible for overseeing that?
the food service director is primarily responsible, and then those individuals working under that individual.
And how many individuals are that?
We have 28 food service employees. Again, of those 28, seven work enough hours to be eligible to be in the membership.
So you've got a report from DESC. Did we receive a copy of that report?
You did, back in March or April.
And the audit, that's still just in the draft stage?
Yeah, it's the independent audit that I commissioned when I arrived here. Yes, it's a draft. The partner in the accounting firm that did the audit is available at the committee's wish to come in and discuss it with you.
Okay, so the report we got is the report you're talking about?
You haven't seen this yet.
No, the DESC report.
That's one.
And is this isolated to this year, or is this a problem that's been going on for many years that you can tell?
It's a long-standing problem that has been documented pretty extensively over the years.
That's a question. Thank you.
Any other questions?
Any other questions?
We will continue to keep the two boards updated, whether they be joint meetings or individual meetings. Agenda, but we are in open session, and rather than wait till our next meeting, which isn't for some time, I was just hoping the K-8 board would authorize the draft of the principal for Wilbur School to be posted. Notice there's no salary established, this is a salary negotiable, and I didn't have a date there, but with your authorization, I'd like to also proceed with posting that position.
For purposes of discussion, I'll make a motion that we authorize the superintendent to post the position of principal of the Wilbur Elementary School.
Second. Motion and second. Further discussion?
Mr. Chair, once again, I'm just going to ask Mrs. Carrere if she would like us to put a salary range on the posting.
I would say base it on the person's experience rather than putting the salary range.
Okay. Thank you. Any further discussion? All right, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
The chair votes aye as well. It's unanimous. Okay. Anything else?
No.
An executive session is requested in accordance with Chapter 30A, Section 21, for the purpose of discussing negotiations for compensation of the superintendent of schools and to discuss the SDA evaluation negotiations, because an open meeting would have detrimental effect on the board's negotiating position. The committee will not be going back into open session. I need a roll call. I need a motion.
So moved.
Second. We have a motion by Mr. Rebell, second by Mr. Kamara. Roll call.
Aye.
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 And the chair votes aye as well.
For the regional committee, I would request a motion in accordance with Chapter 30A, Section 21, for the purpose of executive session in accordance with Chapter 30A, Section 21, for the purpose of discussing negotiations for compensation of the superintendent of schools and to discuss STA evaluation negotiations. As an open meeting would have a detrimental effect on the board's negotiation position, the board not returning to open session at the conclusion of the executive session.
So moved. Oh, second.
I'm sorry. Was that Liz or motion this way? And seconded by Mr. Souza. Roll call, Mr. Kelly.
Aye.
Mrs. Gagliotti.
Aye.
Mr. Souza.
Aye.
Ms. White.
Aye.
Mr. Machado.
Aye.
The chair votes aye. Thank you.
I'm going to